Hello everyone, welcome. On this holy eve of the 126th birth anniversary of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose and second Parakram Divas, we are glad to have Dr. Shankar Kumar Chatterjee with us to speak on the liberation of India. Dr. Chatterjee, being a deponent of Sahara Commission, has very closely witnessed all the happenings. Without wasting any more further time, let's welcome Dr. Chatterjee on stage to enrich us with lesser known facts. We are also welcome Dr. Chatterjee to garland Netaji's picture and start the operation.
Start. Thank you very much. It's a rare privilege to be addressing this kind of an august audience, the cream de la cream of India in IIT Kanpur. I thank you very much, Professor Tiwari and Professor Bhattacharjee, and my friend Saurabh Bhattacharjee. They invited me here. So, untold stories of enemy number one, Subhash Chandra Bose. That's my topic. Why enemy number one? Who's enemy number one? He was the enemy number one of the British Empire. The British Empire where the sun never set. And this was the man who shook the empire to its very foundations. Subsequently, the empire was known as the Commonwealth, and we are still a member of the Commonwealth. Now let's go ahead. He was here. You see the picture of Subhash Chandra Bose standing to the extreme right. There, big joint family, Janakinath Bose, Prabhupati Devi and all the brothers, and a whole host of, you know, nephews and nieces there. He was born on the 23rd of January 1897. Initial education was at the Baptist Protestant Missionary School in Cuttack amid Europeans and Anglo-Indians, and subsequently Ravenshaw Collegiate School. He came to the Presidency College along with his brothers in Calcutta. There is nationalist leanings came to the fore, and he was expelled following assault on Professor Oten by some students. Actually, he was not a part of the assault. It's a very popular misconception. He had deep spiritual inclinations. He practiced meditation at home. He left home seeking a spiritual guru, moving around in, you know, pilgrimages and temples in northern India. He failed to find a satisfactory guru and he returned home. Subsequently, he got admitted in the Scottish Church College, then he was selected in the IECS. He resigned from the IECS. He came back to India in 1921, joined the Indian National Congress. Deshbandhu Chittaranjan Das, he was his political mentor. Initially, he was the CEO, later mayor of the Calcutta Municipal Corporation. And he joined the group of the Congress, the Young Turks of the then Young Turks of the Congress, who were demanding Purna Swaraj as opposed to dominion status. He had a good rapport with Jawaharlal Nehru in those days. He got imprisoned in Mandalay primarily due to his association with revolutionaries. That was in 1925. In 1928, he was the general officer commanding of the Bengal Volunteers. Actually, that was a cover group to pull all the revolutionaries of India, and he gave ranks to the revolutionaries which they used subsequently throughout their lives. He was arrested by police on several occasions. He was tortured in prison. In 1938, he became the Congress president. He was re-elected in 1939, and because of his demand of Purna Swaraj, the group demanding dominion status sidelined him. So that was the Gandhi-Nehru duo. And according to US intelligence, the latest report has come out, it was British influences which edged him out of the Congress party. Then he founded the Forward Bloc within the Congress, mind you, not outside the Congress. He was bent on not breaking the Congress party, but he got expelled from the Congress party in 1940 while, you know, he was conducting an anti-compromise conference in Ramgarh. He disappeared from his Elgin Road home in Calcutta on, there's a big doubt actually when he went out. 13th and 17th of January 1941, and he reached, after 4 months, he reached Nazi Germany via Afghanistan and Russia. It was a long, perilous, troublesome journey on which really he put his head on the chopping block by going there. Founded the Free Indian Legion, that was Azad Hind Fauj, and that was from the Indian prisoners of war that were taken from Rommel's Africa Corps in North Africa. And then the radio broadcasts from Berlin began, that this is Subhash Chandra Bose speaking. He left KL. Subsequently, what happened was the tide of the war changed and things happened very fast. Hitler decided upon, you know, embarking on Operation Barbarossa, invaded Russia. So his plans of coming overland, through the overland route from through southern Europe and West Asia, you know, didn't work out. So he decided to shift base to Southeast Asia. He left KL on a German submarine in February 1943, and another perilous journey began. And he changed to a Japanese submarine near Madagascar among very rough and choppy seas. Surfaced in Penang, Malaysia, in a Japanese submarine, he assumed the leadership of the Indian National Army and the Indian Independence League from Raj Bihari Bose. He revamped the defunct INA. Earlier, INA was formed by Captain Mohan Singh. So that was disbanded and that was in a state of limbo. He revamped it. His officers came from the old British Indian Army and the soldiers from the British Indian Army, mostly from the Punjab Regiment, and expatriate Indians in Southeast Asia. A large number of Tamilian workers from the Malaya rubber plantations. He proclaimed the Provisional Government of Free India in Exile on the 21st of October 1943, fulfilling requirements of international law. There was land in his possession. Expatriate Indians gave him support, and he had his own currency, he had his own army, and he had the recognition of I think 9 member states of the then League of Nations. So that satisfied the requirements of international law. According to international law, it was a valid government. This clause was later utilized by Bhulabhai Desai during the INA trials. And it was the only government in the Axis side which actually never surrendered at the end of the war. It just declared a ceasefire and ceased to function. Indian tricolor was raised over Andaman and Nicobar Islands at the Gymkhana Club, Port Blair, on 30th of December 1943. The islands were named Shahid and Swaraj. Battle of Imphal and Kohima was fought in between March and May 1944. It was a huge attrition. 26,000 INA casualties out of a 40,000 strong force. 26,000 casualties, this is more than 3 Indo-Pak wars, 4 Indo-Pak wars if you take the Kargil. You know, 1948, 1965, 1971 and Kargil. So many casualties did not happen if you take these 4 wars together. And the British War Museum, an institution in Britain, they have adjudged this as the toughest battle of the British Empire. Toughest battle of the British Empire, ranking it above the Battle of Waterloo and so many other battles, El Alamein and so on and so forth. Retreat began because of inevitable reasons. World War II ended with Japanese surrender on the 15th of August 1945. And on 22nd of August, the Domei Private News Agency of Japan announced Netaji's death in an alleged air crash at Taihoku Airport, that is modern Taiwan. Today it is known as the Matsuyama Airport, on the 18th of August 1945. Both the British and the US intelligence, they disbelieved the report. Field Marshal Lord Archibald Wavell stated, "I wonder if the Japanese announcement of Subhash Chandra Bose's death is true. I suspect it very much. It is what should be given out if he were to go underground." So the mystery, the doubts about his death began right from Field Marshal Lord Archibald Wavell, not from some conspiracy theorist. Okay. So too many glaring inconsistencies in the eyewitness accounts. Some said the plane crashed from 100 feet, some said it is from 10,000 feet, some said it went spiraling down, some said it crashed, I mean straight. And There were people who said, three of us tried to rescue Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Habibur Rahman said, I was the lone person who was trying to douse the flames. He was burning. So there, it's full of inconsistencies. Only Netaji, Lieutenant General Sunamasa Shidei and flying officer Nonagaki, the pilot, they are reported to have died because they needed to disappear. And the rest escaped unscathed. There are others, including Colonel Habibur Rahman, his adjutant, they escaped completely unscathed. Only Habibur Rahman's, he showed some scar mark at the back of his left hand. That was subsequently, you know, one can't have that sort of minor injury when a plane nosedives from that height. The death certificate issued from Nanmon Military Hospital mentions the name Ichiro Okura, not Subhash Chandra Bose. The dead body that was cremated was not identified at the crematorium. No photograph of a dead head of state, come military commander in chief of the Liberation Army, ever produced. Colonel Habibur Rahman subsequently produced a square or a rectangular, whatever you say, a wristwatch, and Netaji always wore a round wristwatch. And Rahman's evasive replies to the CSDIC, that is Combined Services Detailed Interrogation Center of the Allied Forces, when they were catching war criminals, enemy commanders, etc. And subsequently to Sarath Bose, the elder brother of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, at his residence in Woodburn Park. Colonel J.K. Bhosle, who was in the meantime the chief of staff of the INA, he was also interrogated, and he spilled the beans, actually, that he said that Netaji planned to go to Shanghai to contact the Russians through the Chinese if the Japanese did not take up his cause. He was prodding on the Japanese to speak to the Russians to let him in, so that he could subsequently reorganize the Indian National Army from Russia and carry on his struggle. He also had Ho Chi Minh in his mind. The Taiwan government, in their own inquiry report of 1956, denied that there was ever any plane crash. They said that no plane took off on the 18th of August. And subsequently, in an email reply to my dear friend Anuj Dhar, they categorically stated there was no plane took off, so there was no air crash in Taihoku on the 18th of August 1945. Now the fun begins. The drama begins. Post crash, Alfred Waugh, Chicago Tribune. He was a correspondent, come a US intelligence officer. He saw Netaji at a hotel in Saigon on the 24th of August after his supposed air crash death, where he was in a meeting with Vietnamese leaders. Ho Chi Minh was there and another Chinese general was there. So he openly challenged Nehru in a meeting in Delhi regarding the death report and why Subhash Chandra Bose should not be dealt with as a war criminal, since he was responsible for the death of so many Allied soldiers during the Second World War. In 1946, Deven Sen and K.N. Jogalekar, both of them were trade union leaders of that time, they saw Netaji in full military uniform at Marseille Airport in France. Then Galacher, the British communist leader, he claimed that Bose visited Imondi Valera in 1946. Subsequently, when Imondi Valera came to India, he was asked that so-and-so has told us that Subhash Chandra Bose had visited you. So what do you say to that? You see, he gave a cryptic and a strange reply. He said, I was expecting to meet him here in India. On the 7th of October 1949, Sarath Bose's newspaper, The Nation, it front-paged a report, Netaji alive in Red China, adding that the government of India had a definite intelligence regarding Netaji's presence in Red China. Same thing comes out in Bombay tabloid Blitz. Does it still exist? Or it has ceased to exist? Well, because I remember I used to take Blitz, when I was a young kid, actually, and in my teens and college days, I used to follow Blitz. In 1949, a German news agency, Interpress, they published a story titled Babu Bose, Man Hinterden Fountain, the man behind the front, which also said Bose was in Red China. On the 7th of December 1949, Muthuramalingam Thevar, He came and met Sarath Bose, Netaji's elder brother, the famous barrister in Calcutta. Sarath Bose did not, he was ailing, he was having heart ailments, and he was not expecting to live long. He called Muthuramalingam Thevar. He was an ardent follower of Netaji. He stayed with Sarath Bose for 10 days and after that he vanished. He just vanished. Subsequently, he resurfaced in India 1 year later. He was a very prominent leader of South India. He came back 1 year later. He said that he had been to China through Myanmar, I mean Burma. And somewhere near, you know, Sinkiang, that is Turkestan, he was with Netaji. And there Netaji was in command of a Asian Liberation Army comprising of, you know, Asians, Eurasians and people of different races. There was a huge army and he was in charge of that. He decided not to disclose anything. He said that the government of India should come out clearly, openly say that, declare whether he is a war criminal or not. If the government of India states that he is not a war criminal, I can speak further, or else this is what I have to say. Government of India maintained a stony silence. Priyadarshi Mukherjee is still there, professor of Chinese and Sinological Studies at Jawaharlal Nehru University. He thinks that the Chinese are holding documents about Subhash Chandra Bose, documents to which even the Chinese do not have access. Now let's go back again to 1946. This is a letter from Khurshid Ben Nauroji to Louis Fisher. Khurshid Ben Nauroji was the personal secretary of Mahatma Gandhi. And she is the granddaughter of, you know, Dadabhai Nauroji, the grand old man of the Congress. And she is writing to Louis Fisher, who was very close to President Harry S. Truman. So Louis Fisher was being used as a sounding board. I hope you understand what I mean. Dear Fisher, I enclose a copy of Gandhi's letter to you. At heart, the Indian Army is sympathetic to the Indian National Army. If Bose comes with the help of Russia, neither Gandhiji nor the Congress will be able to reason with the country. This document was produced from the Princeton University Mudd's Library, Princeton University Archives, and it was exhibit number 228 in the Justice Mukherjee Commission of Enquiry. British intelligence report. Muradov, the Russian consul general in Tehran, disclosed in March 46 that Bose was in Russia, where he is secretly organizing a group of Russians and Indians to work on the same lines as the INA for the freedom of India. This is file number 273, INA JMCI, exhibit number 300. There is a radio message from Netaji on the 26th of December. This was intercepted in Shimla. I am at present under the shelter of a great world power, and he expected to come to India at the crest of a third world war. So this is PMO file number 870/11/P/16/92.pol. This is JMCI exhibit number 245. In February 1954, the US publication National Republic, in its essay titled Jawaharlal Nehru and the Red Threat to India, writes, "There is a strong possibility that Bose is alive. At the end of the war, when the front collapsed in Burma, Bose, if he showed himself, ran the great risk of being prosecuted as a war international war criminal." So this is the picture of the newspaper, The Nation, edited by Sarath Bose. And we have the most truthful man of the last century. Anybody? Can you recognize him? Yes, this was Lord Clement Attlee, who was sitting on the hot seat when the Indian Independence Act was signed. This is Lord Clement Attlee, very truthful British Prime Minister. He was visiting after his prime ministership was over again. Churchill had come back and he was in India at that time. Fani Bhushan Chakravarti, he was the Chief Justice. P.B. Chakravarti, the Chief Justice of the Calcutta High Court, was also doubling up as the West Bengal Governor. So in the Raj Bhavan, the two were having lunch. P.V. Chakravarti was very curious. He just innocently asked that this, at that time in 1947, by that time the Quit India movement had petered out. The British were on top of the world. They had just won the Second World War. So why did you leave India? Why did he leave India? So he just said the activities of Subhash Chandra Bose and his INA. He further elaborated that it was because of these activities that the, you know, the Indian troops, they had lost their, you know, allegiance to the British, their British officers and the British masters. The British could no longer rely on the Indian troops. There had been, you know, uncontrollable revolts within the Indian Navy, starting from Aden to Myanmar, huge revolt. The only thing to, you know, blow up, waiting to blow up, was the Indian Army and the Indian Air Force. Even Eurasian officers, they were disobeying their British superiors. So, I mean, the earlier they could wind up shop and go, the safer it was for them. Simple. Then Justice P.B. Chakravarti asked him, what about the, you know, the civil disobedience, non-cooperation movement led by the father of the nation? So his lips twisted in a derisive smile and he said, M-I-N-I-M-A-L, minimal. Now comes the unknown part. Now, I am saying this with a lot of trepidations, because officially we have not been able to prove in the courts of India that the reclusive monk named Bhagwanji is actually Netaji. Means we have not been able to make a judge say this. Otherwise, you decide for yourself who he was. The Khampa rebellion broke out against the brutal Chinese occupation of Tibet in 1955. A band of guerrilla warriors, Khampas, you know, they are a western Tibetan tribe, very warlike people, fiercely independent. So they started fighting the Chinese and they started fighting a guerrilla war. In the meantime, the Tibetans, they are very devout Buddhists. They regard the Dalai Lama as the living god. The Chinese were trying hard to make the Dalai Lama toe their line. Dalai Lama at that time was very young. I think he was only 20, 21 years. 19 years.
9 years?
No. He was not 9 years.
No, in 1950,
yeah, about 19 years. Yeah. He was around 19, 20 years maybe. Very young. So, they sent a General Chang. He was the commanding officer of the PLA in Lhasa. Lhasa was the headquarters, so local headquarters, regional headquarters. He sent a very peculiar invitation that, Your Holiness, please come, we have an auditorium, something like this, and you will address our Chinese troops, but you are not allowed to bring your own security, we will give you security. So that was when, you know, the alarm bell sounded, and this, it was conveyed to him that he will go there and he will never come back. He will be shipped Peking. Those days Beijing used to be called Peking. So like Panchen Nama. So you will go to Peking and you will never come back. So he decided not to go there. The Chinese, you know, the PLA, they got suspicious. They also got wind of something, you know, amiss. The Potla Palace was surrounded by the Chinese PLA. They started shelling. The Khampa Tibetan guerrilla warriors, they surrounded Lhasa from all sides. They also converged over Lhasa from all sides. And then one fine evening, they let loose Tibetan hounds who were trained to, you know, jump on the Chinese troops. How they managed it, I don't know. General Death or General Shiva, the identity has never been established, was the military commander who gave the signal to attack. The Red Army was in total surprise. General Death, he quickly set up base in the basement of the Lhasa Medical College and directed guerrilla operations for nearly 3 days. A brutal fight actually ensued. The Dalai Lama left Lhasa in the guise of a young Khampa monk. There was a escort group waiting on the outskirts of Lhasa, and the moment they went away from there, they took the route to India. The moment the news reached that Dalai Lama has gone to a safe distance, the guerrilla fighters simply evaporated. They melted away into the hills. The PLA let loose their air force, looking for, the Dalai Lama and his caravan here and there. On the penultimate day, they got the news that he was on the road to India. So what happened was, I have seen that place, that I was in the Special Services Bureau, that is the Sashastra Seema Bal. I was posted all over the borders. So there's a post called Khinjamani in Arunachal. So those days it used to be called Nefa. So that's where from Khinjamani, His Holiness, he came, his caravan came into India, and head constable or Hawaldar of the Assam Rifles, he greeted him, he received him on our side. He's still alive, very old man. So near Khinjamani, while still on the Tibetan side, the PLF, the People's Liberation Air Force, they located the caravan. The moment they were about to, you know, rain their bombs, somehow a fog appeared and miraculously saved, you know, Dalai Lama. So this incident, I'll tell you all, please look into the YouTube. There's a BBC documentary. Not anybody's any Tom, Dick and Harry's cock and bull story. It's BBC's documentary. They have mentioned the incident. And Bhagwanji also mentioned the same incident. But that was in the 70s, in the back of the beyond, you know, place in, he was sitting in Purani Basti. And he knew the story that, you know, for half a century later, the BBC would let out. So BBC documentary in the YouTube matches Bhagwanji's description of the events. And about the identity of General Death, the author of the book, my friend Anuj, he sent an email that what about the identity of General Death? So he said it's a total mystery to me. I have the book with me. Bappa Shardar sent it to me from he, I don't, I picked up a copy from USA. I don't know how he managed to procure one. So this is that fateful journey they are taking, risky journey. And the Tibetan guerrilla warriors, you can see, the Khampa guerrillas. Chushi Gundruk, that is the name of the Tibetan Khampa army. There they are. Now about Bhagwanji, the mysterious monk. He entered India in 1955 via Nepal, stayed in Sringarnagar near Lucknow during the initial years. Subsequently, 1960 to 1964, he was at Naimisharanya, Nimsar. In 1964, where we have found a telegram by Anil Das, alias Renu, he was from the INA. From Faizabad on 25-64 to Lee, that is Leela Ray. After shifting from Nimsar, we reached sound all well. So we'll come to Leela Ray later on. Key persons involved in shifting were Santosh Bhattacharya, Kamalakant Ghosh and Anil Das. 1964, there's a letter from Santosh Bhattacharya, one of the disciples of Bhagwanji, to Leela Ray, stating that they are searching for a better place to Deedan place, which was full damp and full of flies. There was a single door in out. Yes, Bhagwanji was Bhagwanji the saint. He was very particular that this wherever house he stays must have so many levers of a lock, must have a different entry and a different exit, and must have water tank like this, septic tank like this, all German models. Mind you, a saint sitting somewhere in the back of the beyond village in some obscure place and you know, having so many specifications. And he was punctual, you know, he was very particular to everything, that this should be like this, that should be like that. Anything out of way, he would simply reject. Then he was in Lal Koti in Ayodhya district from August 1964 to March 1965, Shanti Sadan, Patantola, Purani Basti, UP. There he stayed the longest actually. No, I'm sorry. The 9th March till 21st May. Then Raja Maidan, Purani Basti. This is where he stayed the longest, from May 1965 to December 1976, 11 years. So he shifted with the help of Dulal Nandi. Dulal Nandi, incidentally, was my father's friend. And we never imagined that my Dulal Kaku was involved in all this, in my wildest dreams. When the Mukherjee Commission newspaper report came out, I confronted him that, are you the same Dulal Nandi? Then he said, yes. One word is yes. Then I said, we never knew this. He said, how will you know? Even your aunt did not know. Your auntie did not know. How will you know? So he was in Chittaranjan Locomotive Works. He was a very big contractor, self-made person. He owned two cinema halls. He had a distributorship of so many newspapers over there, and he was responsible for the repair works of all the railway quarters. Those days he was a very, very, very big man. He's passed away. He spent enormous amounts of money after Bhagwanji. Unfortunately, today his family is in dire financial distress. Then subsequently, Brahmakund, Ramkot Ward, Ajodhya, then in UP, 1977. Then he was from December 1981 to August 1982, he was in very difficult situation in Lucknow Hatta, Lucknow Wali Hatta, in Ajodhya. I have gone to that place. Even daytime, actually, he had no electricity. All day he had to light a kerosene lamp. The walls were damp. The room was cold. Subsequently, I mean, the last known place that he stayed was from September 1983 to September 16, 1985. He stayed in Ram Bhavan Civil Lines. The house owner's name was Gurbasant Singh. I met his son, I've met both of them, father and son, Gurbasant Singh and Shakti Singh. He was under the protection and, you know, care of Dr. Raghunath Prasad Mishra. He was a MS and senior surgeon. His family used to look after him, and they used to send food and everything and whatnot, his favorite items. Also, you know, off and on, there was Dr. T. Banerjee and his family, Priyabrata Banerjee, his son, his wife, Rita Banerjee. So they all used to come and look after him. So who were his visitors? Atul Sen, he was a MLA of Undivided Bengal. So he had actually come to Neemsar to recover his health, and there he accidentally bumped into, you know, Bhagwanji in a temple where he was sitting behind the curtain. He subsequently came back to Calcutta. He wrote a short letter to Jawaharlal Nehru saying that I am writing from my knowledge that Netaji is in India. I am keeping the place obscure because we need to know whether he is a war criminal or not. How Bhagwanji got wind of the letter, we don't know, and we shall never know. Bhagwanji promptly cut off all ties with him. So he was not allowed to visit him again. UP Chief Minister Sampurnanand, he used to look after his needs, and apparently he visited him also. Leela Ray was a revolutionary from Dhaka, a long time associate of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose since 1920, That was when the cholera epidemic broke out in Calcutta, and she was a volunteer. She worked with him. She was a very close confidant. Then subsequently, she became a follower of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. When ultimately Subhash Bose split his ways with the Congress, founded the Forward Bloc, she and her future husband Anil Ray, she was Leela Nag actually. Her son is Bijoy Nag. So, Leela Ray, her portrait is there in the parliament. Leela Ray's portrait is there. She was a member of the Constituent Assembly. Subsequently, when the partition was enacted, she resigned in protest. She left the Constituent Assembly. Dr. Pavitra Mohan Ray, he was intelligence officer of the INA. Anil Das, nicknamed Renu, he was also from the INA. Sunil Das, Sunil Krishna Gupta, these were two revolutionaries. Sunil Das was a brilliant chemistry research scholar. He gave up, a very good career. Then Sunil Krishna Gupta, he was a confidant of Suresh Chandra Bose, another elder brother of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Samar Guha, very prominent educationist. He has got a textbook of organic chemistry which is still studied in Bengal. Dulal Nandi, I have already mentioned. Kaviraj Kamalakant Ghosh, he was an Ayurvedic doctor. Santosh Bhattacharya, Bijoy Nag, I still work under him. Surajit Das Gupta, Jagatjit Das Gupta, these are two brothers actually. They are from the family of Dinesh Gupta. Have you heard of Dinesh Gupta? He was a revolutionary. Three of them, Binoy, Badal and Dinesh, they led an attack on the writers building in Calcutta. So they are from a very prominent family. Tarun Kumar Mukhopadhyay, he was an insurance agent. He is still living. An unknown number of serving army officers. What Shakti Singh told me was every night at 10 minutes to 12 o'clock at night, punctually a jeep would come at Ram Bhavan. A middle ranking army officer, I mean colonel or lieutenant colonel, major or maybe colonel, used to come there, go 10 minutes of briefing, debriefing, what exchange took place, heaven knows. Within 10 minutes, the jeep would quietly leave. So, have you been there? You've been there. So, just behind this, the Ram Bhavan, just across the wall is the army campus. So, the jeep used to just come over there, the exchanges would take place and then vanish. So, that used to happen. So, unknown number of army officers. There are unconfirmed reports of Chaudhary Charan Singh having gone there. Sri Pranab Mukherjee in 1983. I know the person who took him there, Mr. Ravindra Shukla. I have talked to him. Dr. T. Banerjee, later his son Priyobroto Banerjee. Both of them are no more. His wife Rita Banerjee, she is there. Dr. R. P. Mishra, he is no more. I have met him. Mrs. Mishra, she is also no more. I have met her. Son Nirupam Mishra, I have met him. Shakti Singh, Ravindra Shukla, Dr. Dasrath Tomar, Dr. Birendra Kumar Rai, all of them I have interviewed. Notable people who were in correspondence with him, Atul Sen, Prafulla Chandra Sen, he was former Chief Minister of West Bengal, Dr. Sampurnanand, former UP Chief Minister, Leela Rai, Samar Guha, ABA Gani Khan Chaudhary, you might have heard the name. He was a railway minister, a Congress leader from Malda. Madhav Sadashivrao Golwalkar, he was Sarsanchalak of the RSS. Then Dr. Pavitra Mohan Roy, INA Intelligence. And Basanti Devi, wife of Deshbandhu Chittaranjan Das. What interest would Basanti Devi have in writing to him? Unknown monk sitting somewhere in the back of the beyond in UP. Even the CIA they kept a tab of what was happening. They never uttered the name of Subhash Chandra Bose once in public, but there is a report in 1964 dated 27th of February that states there now exists a strong possibility that Bose is leading a religious group trying to destabilize the current Nehru government. Well, what this religious group is anybody's guess. We can all guess. Here are some pictures actually. So, one visionary, the other a luminary. So, one visionary who thought that the army, India does not need an army. Police forces are enough. We need to have police forces and we should not fight with neighbors. And the luminary V. Krishna Menon, he was our defense minister. He started, you know, this getting these ordnance factories to manufacture household utensils, kettles and, you know, what do you call that? Used for cooking. Hata Khunti, yeah, all these things. So, useful things. So, you look at the Indian Army in action against China in the NEFA, that is Northeastern Frontier Province. Truck has broken down, that is being pulled by ropes. And finally, you see the final result. The right hand bottom corner, that was the Indian Army, hands up, Chinese soldiers surrounding, untold humiliation for the entire nation. Ignominy and humiliation, 1962. What this sannyasi had to say about this war? It was good that India and her government got a big jolt. And this will sound like, you know, as if it is coming from a traitor. But if we look at the, you know, I mean, the significance of this, that actually our false notions of, you know, peaceful coexistence was completely demolished. Unless we had a strong national security policy, anybody will exploit. So it was good that India and our government got a big jolt. It was good that the guru of the guru of treacherous UK's expertise, I think he was referring to China, I have not been able to make out this, was ruthlessly kicking his way ahead. With a sudden loss of resistance, it went ahead exceeding bounds and preconceived plans. That's why I had to rush twice. I had to rush twice means we have known that, we have come to know, he used to tell his disciples that he used to visit, he used to go out of India very frequently. From his place in wherever he used to, he changed a lot of places. But one thing you notice that whichever places he went was always 3 to 4 hours journey from the Nepal border. One, there was no checking at the Nepal border those days. Even now people can slip in and out with consummate ease. You ask all the, I mean, people from Nepal who are working in India, do they have to, you know, produce papers and all that? I don't think. So, he had to rush there twice. He has given details that he actually met Mao Zedong, the Chinese leader, twice. And after 15 days of his return from his second visit, the Chinese actually did a unilateral ceasefire. Now, let me tell you that the four corps that was defending Northeast India was completely demolished by the Chinese. It was completely demolished. The entire Northeast lay defenseless. Tejpur, everybody had left except one telegraph operator who was sitting there, and the British tea planters. Few British tea planters were there, they didn't go. Otherwise, the entire town was completely vacated. One telegraph operator was still there, and our illustrious Prime Minister gave a farewell speech to the people of Northeast India that my heart goes out to the people of Assam. So those days the whole place was Assam. A son of Bengal had sent an expert report on how to stop enemy 100% from the other side of the Himalayas to JN, J full stop, N full stop. Now, whether he was referring to Lieutenant General L.P. Sen, that is Lalit, Lalan Pratip Sen, L.P. Sen, who retired as Lieutenant General. He fought in the Kashmir War also, he fought for the British in the Second World War. So, whether it was L.P. Sen and my friend Anuj feels it was General Thorat. Now, Thorat was not from Bengal. So, somehow an intelligence report went to the Defense Ministry that these are the routes that have to be blocked if India has to be saved from a Chinese attack. And that, funnily, five copies of the report were there. One of them made its way to Pakistan and from there to China. And those were the very routes that the Chinese came through. See, that much porous our foreign policy was. We had nothing by way of national security till the Chinese War. He was witness to Brigadier Dalvi's captivity in PLA territory. If you have heard the name, have you heard the name of Brigadier John Dalvi? Yeah. Himalayan Blunder, famous book that he has written while he was in captivity. So in that book, actually, a copy of that book was found at Ram Bhavan. At the preface, John Dalvi writes that I'm beginning to write this book while I'm in captivity. Now this book Bhagwanji got, and he has written small comment on that, yes, me witness. So he was there. The Chinese apparently sent an extraordinary proposal to the Nehru government, which the government of India ignored. It would have made China lose her position forever in the communist world, and India had a lot to gain. What was the proposal? We don't know, but the information is there. The government of India shot it down. Then he wrote someone, under inverted comma, someone, he used to refer to himself as either someone or ye sharir. Never as me, I, he never used to use those expressions, ye sharir or somebody or so and so. So someone wrote to Nehru, I want to return. Why didn't he reply? In front of the complaining and taunting attitude of the Chinese, someone's face went black and blue in utter shame. The Chinese taunted him that you trusted your friend JLN and he let you down. They said you trusted him wrongly. The resolve thus turned into poisoned steel. You make out what the meaning is. Here you see the Indian army in a different mood, in a different body language. This is Lieutenant Colonel Desmond Haid, commanding officer 3 Jat. He blasted his way through Dogre from that Amritsar, Lahore axis. He crossed the Ichogil Canal, established headquarters at a place called Batapur. Batapur, that is inside Lahore. Indian army was well inside Lahore. Indian soldiers, they chose good shoes from there. Batapur, there was a big Bata factory actually. So, I don't think they paid for it. So, on the other side, you see the Indian, there's a lot of Pakistani, weaponry that has been captured. Indian soldiers charging ahead, and this is Barki police station that is under Indian occupation. So he said that Pakistan, about the war, he said Pakistan received the wink and nod cum diplomatic support from the UK. So it was the UK which was monkeying from behind. The dead ghost, he also referred to himself as dead ghost. Dead ghost thought that the Indian army had earned the reputation of being cowards. Ayub Khan reportedly told Lal Bahadur Shastri on his face in London, that was before the war began, "I can walk over to Delhi any hour I want, you know." Shastri did not reply. "They only know how to be good slaves and lick boots. We'll simply kick them and take Delhi and Kashmir with ease." The Chinese took thousands of Indian troops captive. This is unmentionable slang here. The Indian troops could not take a dead Chinese captive. Spit on them. Now, subsequently, the subsequent events turned otherwise. The Kashmiri Bakarwals, what is Bakarwal? Shepherds. The Kashmiri shepherds, they turned over infiltrators to the Indian army. There was no Kashmiri revolt when, infiltrators were pushed in. Operation Gibraltar, that was named as Operation Gibraltar. That failed miserably. 3 Jat under Colonel Desmond Haid, they crossed the Ichogil Canal, took Dogre and Batapur. Bhagwanji says regarding the peace talks later on, he sent clues by indirect means and someone went around visiting places sending waves of electricity with instantaneous results, like a dog suddenly recovering his own strength and fighting to win. The Indian army counterattacked and blastically Lahore was evacuated by civilians. The Pak military was fleeing like squirrels. It was a matter of punching or taking. Someone had crossed the Ichogil Canal thrice. This is unbelievable. Someone means him. He had crossed the Ichogil Canal thrice. Ichogil Canal was, actually a moat dug all around Lahore as a defense. That indicates that he was personally present. He was visiting those places when in the thick of fighting. We really don't know what happened. Sialkot, Muzaffarabad, and that one third of Kashmir, that is POK, that were a matter of 1 week. At this juncture, Prime Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri and Army Chief J.N. Chaudhary, they wilted under international pressure, calling off the offensive to the immense disgust of the dead ghost. He harshly criticized both Indian and Pakistani military commanders for following set patterns of Sandhurst. Sandhurst, the military school in UK. So they have their own way of teaching, conventional warfare. So Indian officers and Pakistani officers, the earlier officers were all products of Sandhurst. Nowadays, they come from Dehradun in India. So those days, both the Indian and the Pakistani officers, they were batchmates. And they were fighting and clashing in the same way, set patterns, About the Tashkent talks. This will take some time. The Tashkent agreement was prepared earlier without India even knowing about it. Just imagine. Tashkent agreement was signed between India and Pakistan, and that was tailor-made actually. That was tailor-made to Pakistan, was completely, it had gone bust. It did not have any capacity. It was on its last legs. They were unable to fight any longer. Unfortunately, some wisecrack gave a wrong news to our Chief of Staff General J.N. Chaudhary that our ammunition is also spent. It was not spent. Only 1/5 of our ammunition had been spent. Whether it was done deliberately or not, God knows. After the plan was prepared and ready, Russia posed as the only friend of India and got down to business to extricate Pakistan and to help her be strong for another clash. Now we take Russia as our all-time friend, all-weather friend, etc., etc. But see, at that point of time, they were trying to protect Pakistan. Somehow it was conveyed to LB, that is Lal Bahadur, that he was clearly warned, please do not feel smug. Do not trust Russia, you are no match for them. Invite them on Indian soil if Russia is really a friend as you think. But he lost his head, Pakistan gained what it wanted, Russia, UK and Russia, so R is for Russia, they gained what they wanted. And surprise of surprises, when Ayub met Shastri at Tashkent, they sat down in one room and Ayub said to LB, Lal Bahadur in Urdu, Jo ho gaya, so ho gaya, ab to rahm karo. Now, this is typical Fauji Urdu. This is typical Fauji Urdu. And Ayub Khan is speaking to Lal Bahadur Shastri. Now, one thing, when they are sitting one to one, unless a third person has heard that, you know, what transpired in between them, how can he know? Ayub projected himself as a small brother and Shastriji as the big brother. Now comes 50 years later actually. Pictures resembling Netaji was found in the web at the Indo-Pak Tashkent peace talks following 1965 Indo-Pak war in 2014. Now who found it out? There is a group called Anonymous. Are you aware? Anonymous, ethical hackers. They found it out. They handed over the picture to one person called Siddharth Sadbhai. Siddharth Sadbhai is an NRI. He is staying in UK these days. He was born here, but he was brought up in the Netherlands. Now he is working in UK as an IT professional. So actually he was working with Anuj. Somehow they fell apart. Then that fellow contacted me. Then he told that I have pictures to give. I have pictures of this, you know, Subhash Chandra Bose at Tashkent. So I disbelieved him. I said, I think you had a bad dream or something like that. So he said, no, I've got it from this anonymous group and it is very suggestive. So I said, unless you show it to me, there's no point talking about it. Then he sent me one picture. I sat up almost whole night and then, you know, British Pathé, there's an online video archive, British Pathé. So from British Pathé, I was able to, you know, take out stills from that, this thing. Then I was also convinced. Then, you know, a flood of pictures and videos, they were sourced from as places like RIO Novosti, that is TASS News Agency, Russia, Kent Picture Library, UK, British Pathé, which I have already told you, and Chugtai Museum, Lahore, Pakistan, all yielding images of the same familiar figure with unknown identity. That person is there all over the place. I sent RTI letters, the replies are here. That RTI query has really circulated a long way inside the Indian government. Ministry of Information or Broadcasting, Ministry of External Affairs, the Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran desk, that is spy desk. Everybody says that we don't have any information as to the identity of this person. So we have found out what the Indian contingent, peace contingent comprised of, what the Pakistani delegation comprised of. So my question was whether he is a member of either of the two delegations, because this person looks like a South Asian. He is not a Russian. He looks like a South Asian. So either he is a member of the delegation or he is a press member. So which media, what is his name and which media house was he representing? And if none of these are there, then what was he doing there? No reply. Reply is there, no information. So we sent it, you know, to the huge number of pictures. We sent to the British expert Neil Millar, who reported in a 62-page non-judicial format. He is also a Britisher, very clever person. Now let's look at the pictures. The man at the right upper corner. Does it resemble somebody we know? So I won't go into, you know, the huge number of pictures are there. it will take all night. So he has reported, if I were to utilize this scale in this particular analysis, taking into consideration my findings, I will be of the opinion that the imagery, both still and moving, there was a video also that has been supplied to me in regards to the historical facial features of Subhash Chandra Bose and the unknown, the individual identified as a Tashkent man, it lends support, leaning towards strong support to the contention that they are one and the same person. Mind you, he is not an Indian expert. All the Indian experts I called over phone, the moment they heard the subject, they just cut the connection. They just banged the receiver, nothing doing. Should further information be determined in regards to the potential eye conditions mentioned in figure 30, I will show you that. And further imagery of the Tashkent man that might surrender more details such as moles and pockmarks seen on the face of Subhash Chandra Bose, I would be of the opinion that the level of support might increase to powerful support, that Subhash Chandra Bose and the individual identified as the Tashkent man are the same person. Now one thing I am telling you, Neil Millar has never given powerful support in his entire life to any of his findings. He is a very well known, you know, expert in the UK. His opinion is accepted as expert opinion in all the courts of United Kingdom. This is a picture of Subhash Chandra Bose, known picture of Subhash Chandra Bose. If you see, there are certain, you know, peculiarities in his eyes. Actually, they are not in the same axis. Thoda sa teda hai. You understand what I mean? So that's called strabismus. In medical term, it's called strabismus. Number two, the left cornea is slightly larger than the right cornea. That is called anisocornea. Anisocornea and strabismus. Incidentally, the Tashkent man has got the same anisocornea and the same strabismus, in addition to the same facial features. Okay, so Tashkent man is standing behind. You can see on this side is General Ayub Khan. Okay, in the same picture, I'll show you later on. Bhutto is also there. You know, Bilawal Bhutto's grandfather. Okay, so the same anisocornea and the same strabismus. I think this is an absolute clincher. Now, the British expert, in order to stay out of the controversies of Indian politics, has downplayed his report. He has just downplayed his report. He does not want to appear in any court in India. He has openly said that to Siddharth Sadbhai. I don't want to get into trouble with your Indian politics. So he has downplayed his report. So that's about the Tashkent man. About the Vietnam War, Bhagwanji to his disciples, the US has fought more than 60 wars since the Second World War and not won a single one of them. What is this single? Yeah. Winston Churchill could not pronounce S. So he was mimicking Churchill. It was at your dead man's behest that hundreds of tons of heroin was made available to the US troops in Vietnam. Look at his mischief. The troops became incapable of fighting. Now, New York Times report in 1971 says nearly 51% of the US troops in Vietnam were heroin or marijuana addicts. There are some other reports which that US PubMed, you know, I've been looking into this. That said 23% became addicts, so the number varies, but definitely heroin was supplied to them so that they would not be able to fight. And then he has also mentioned cryptically, whenever a small country fighting the greatest military power on earth used to sit for negotiations, their team comprised of a pride of 9 generals with a shadow behind them. 9 generals with a shadow behind them. He is the shadow. So he was present in the US North Vietnam Paris peace talks, according to him. And he was also apparently present in 1973 when the final agreement was signed, after which the USA withdrew all its forces from Vietnam and made a safe exit. And there's a detailed description of the side room talk, often quite, you know, heated argument with US, Chinese, Russian representatives. So this is the New York Times report dated May 16, 1971. GI heroin addiction epidemic in Vietnam. This is the report that shares, that tells of 51% addiction. See, this is the hall in Paris in which the North Vietnamese delegation is walking in. This is a very blurry, you know, video that I've been able to source from the open domain, I mean public domain. If you look at this figure here, it's not in very sharp focus, but to me the figure looks quite familiar. He is dressed himself, he is posing as a reporter, he is taking some notes on a notebook, and this picture. Those who are sitting there, Lee Duc Tho, have you heard the name of Lee Duc Tho? Then Zuan Thuy, then Madam Nguyen Thi Binh. Her picture is not here, she was sitting somewhere either to the left or to the right. Madam Nguyen Thi Binh, Lee Duc Tho, who got the Nobel Peace Prize later on, I mean he was named with Henry Kissinger. Henry Kissinger, who facilitated the Bangladesh, you know, genocide. So, since Henry Kissinger was one of the recipients, Lee Duc Tho refused to take the Nobel Prize. So, yes it is. Iconic picture, India's finest hour. Does anyone need to be introduced about this? Does anyone need any introduction for this picture? Anybody? All of you know the event? Yeah. This is Imran Khan's uncle sitting there. Imran Khan's Niazi. This is General Amir Abdullah Niazi, AAK Niazi, and General Jagjit Singh Arora standing behind him. At the extreme corner is General JFR Jacob, who was the brain behind the, you know, Blitzkrieg campaign. It was shortest surgical military campaign in recent history. 2 weeks and one entire wing of the country was simply cut off, you know, surgically cut off with minimum bloodshed. There was bloodshed, no doubt, but it was minimum. About the Bangladesh Liberation War, his predictions to his followers in 1965-66 of a coming upheaval in East Pakistan and millions of refugees. In 65-66, he said that so many people will rush in, he will be unable to manage. Then he says, I do not want to mention, it will be a line written in history that this place was known for some time as Pakistan. Mahakal, to his followers, he was also Mahakal. Mahakal is and has been working so actively that Pakistan will be forced to murder Kutch and Tashkent. Now, Kutch and Tashkent, after skirmishes in Kutch and in Tashkent, both the instances, they were peace agreements. Pakistan will be forced to murder those peace agreements. It was indeed forced to murder those peace agreements because the pressure in the eastern wing became so much that in order to relieve the pressure in the eastern wing, actually our regular forces were also fighting. This is something I am breaking to you. I worked with the Special Services Bureau. I worked under officers who had gone in incognito, wearing lungis and, you know, vests, posing as Bangladeshis. And they were training the Bangladeshis how to, you know, use the weapons and guerrilla tactics. So our forces were fighting there, regular forces. So what they did, they made a preemptive air attack on our western airfields. And then the war broke out. He declared war, so they broke those two agreements. He has written, such a terrible situation will be created in East and West, West and East Pakistan, that to crush East Pak, he has to act like Nadir Shah. If he fails, then someone else will be sent to act as Pura Nadir Shah. It is Pura Nadir Shah. It happened actually, because Tikka Khan was unable to, you know, control the whole thing, whole stuff. Then Niazi was sent in, so indicating an impending genocide in, but this was long before the war happened. He was predicting all these things. In April 1971, he told the Bhagwanji I am talking of, not Subhash Chandra Bose. Whether they are the same person or not, will you decide. In 1971 April, he toured the entire East Pakistan in a boat disguised as a Maulvi and speaking to crowds who were gathered on the shores. He moved in and out of East Pakistan many times. He castigated Mujibur Rahman. He didn't have a very good opinion of Mujibur Rahman. Then a follower come confidant, he led a Swedish TV group to a jungle near the East Pakistan border where the Mukti Bahini was training. Actually, our border security force and the SSB, they were training the Mukti Bahini. That is where a follower, he instructed the follower, you take the Swedish TV group, they are coming from Europe. He had contacts with them. You will take them there, so and so place. There you will show them what is going on, let them film. Let them film. They filmed it, they telecast it. That was when the world, first time the world knew that, okay, fine, this is a regular liberation war going on, not some mischievous Indian propaganda. There was a small radio station operating in the West Bengal East Pak border. They were giving accurate updates of the war even before the All India Radio was able to broadcast. Mysterious things. And a speech used to come that I have been fighting with you with a rifle on my back for many years. I have been with you then, I am with you even today. Now, Mujibur Rahman, on his release from Pakistan, he went to London. From UK, he came back to here, India, Delhi, then Kolkata, and he made a statement, actually, that was a Freudian slip, I think, that Bangladesh has become free proves Netaji is still alive. That was a Freudian slip, because he was in contact with this, you know, with Bhagwanji. Thereafter, he met our Prime Minister, the then Prime Minister Mrs. Gandhi, and then he didn't utter a word about it after that. Now, there are reports actually of whether it was a military hydrofoil. You know what is a hydrofoil? Very fast boat, you know, actually that goes above the water level. Our hovercrafts of the Coast Guard. Have you seen any one of you? Have you seen the hovercrafts? They just go a little above the water level. They have, you know, some projections below that helps to, you know, just skim the water surface as it goes. And behind it, there are huge rotor blades actually that propels the air behind. So, whether it was a military hydrofoil or a speedboat or multipurpose sea vessel, Jugbani, though there used to be a newspaper those days, they mentioned that such a craft is moving around in the Bay of Bengal and the Indian coast carrying Netaji in it. Netaji is present in that boat or hovercraft or military vessel, whatever it is. So, Dr. Pavitra Mohan Roy, he sent that copy of the newspaper to Bhagwanji. Ye kya ho raha hai? Bhagwanji wrote a letter saying that this was a midget man of war. Midget man of war. Man of war means a middle-sized warship of a superstructure of a luxury yacht. But below it had so many armaments and everything, it had devastating destructive power, and that was moving along the Indian sea coast. It was built by a country which was highly scientifically advanced, and he was riding the most complete version of that vessel. That letter is still there, is Dr. Pavitra Mohan Roy's letter. It is there. So, Anuj has reproduced it in Conundrum, if you have read it. Lastly comes the shocker actually. That was the year was 1975. Lot of, you know, Bhagwanji's followers, they were utterly joyful that, okay, Bangladesh has become free. Many of them were from the other side. Then now we will go back to our homes. So, 1975 it was, he gave a stern warning to his followers, do not go or stay in Bangladesh after the 14th of August 1975. 15th of August 1975, Mujibur Rahman is killed in a coup. There is an army coup, the entire order is reversed. So, this is our Supreme Commander, the last known photograph at Saigon Airport. But I believe the last word is yet to be said. Thank you very much. This was my humble presentation. Have I taken more time than was given? So, no, I'd like to invite, some time for discussions.
Yeah. So, we'll now open the floor for discussion. If you have any questions, our volunteers will be happy to give the mic.
Sorry? Yeah, this is where he is coming down from the plane in Saigon. And after that, all the big puzzle begins actually.
So maybe whoever has questions, please raise your hand so that our volunteers can So just start with it.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Hi.
Myself, Major Lalit, I'm a defense officer. So during our childhood, I'm just because way back in maybe 97, 98.
You're an army man?
Yeah.
Okay, nice to meet you.
In Hindi book, I read a word because you mentioned the Saigon airport and all those things about the mysterious death and all those things. That there's a place called Formosa in Japan.
Yes,
where
that is Taiwan.
Actually took place.
That is Taiwan. Yeah. Formosa, those days used to be called Formosa. Formosa, and nowadays it is called Taiwan. That is again the
odd. I was under the impression that event actually happened in Japan instead of.
No. This so-called air crash is supposed to have happened in Formosa or Taiwan. There, in the airport, the logbook is still there. The airport logbook is still there. Nobody wanted to go and have a look. Justice Mukherjee went and had a look. He inspected the logbook. No plane took off on that day, 18th of August, 1945.
And the can you please throw some light on the incidents of when Netaji moved to Russia and Japan in January 1941?
Correct.
I think he boarded a train.
Yes, yes.
Or something.
Yes, yes, yes.
So under the disguise, he moved up.
To yes, yes. See, there are two, three, four narratives actually what exactly happened. We don't know even he was so secretive person in nature, we still don't know what happened. The only established narrative we have is that of Sisir Bose, his nephew. He has written that he went under the guise of one Muhammad Ziauddin. Okay, so insurance agent, aristocratic of aristocratic lineage from North India. So Ziauddin, he was under the garb of Ziauddin. He was driven by his nephew from Elgin Road right up to a place called Barari Coke Works. Barari Coke Works, that is where Mr. Ashoknath Bose, another nephew,
he traveled some 300 kilometers.
Yes. In a wanderer car, that was the only model of the car that was existing in India at that time. Sisir Bose drove the car from Kolkata to Barari Coke Works, that is near Dhanbad. The initial plan was to drop him at Asansol. But Asansol, they skipped because Asansol was full of Europeans and Anglo-Indians. So those days, you know, it was very unsafe. So he would be easily identified because of the nephew, not because of the uncle. Uncle was disguised. Nephew was not disguised. So immediately there would be suspicion. So they went to a place called Gomo. Barari Kokpas, from Barari Kokpas, they went to Gomo at night. Kalka Mail came, he was, you know, dispatched from the Kalka Mail. So he left on Kalka Mail. But there are some query marks actually. There's a CIA report which says that he left disguised as Sikh. That Ms. Mamata Banerjee, she raised some 64 files. Usme likha hua hai ki wo sardar ke bhes mein nikal gaye. But we don't have any confirmed report exactly what happened. Now, there's also another thing. Sisir Bose was, I think, 20 years or something of that age. He was a medical student at that time.
I think he was 20 old.
Did he have a driving license? Or could he drive that well, actually, from Calcutta to... That's a significant distance, actually. So, overnight, he drove. Might have driven. I can't say. Now, because I said this story to somebody who was also making a video of my speech. And what that fellow did was, he just cut off that CIA portion and he put it in the YouTube. People got after me and started lambasting me that you are propagating a lie. So I am very cagey about, you know, this thing. Bhagwanji, in his deliberations, he said that the last, you know, visit he paid was to Rabindranath Tagore before he left.
Okay.
Now that makes it all the more puzzling, because Rabindranath Tagore at that time was in Bolpur. So did he board the train in Burdwan, or did he board the train in Gomo? I don't know. Again, the family of Ashoknath Bose, Mrs. Jayanti Rakshit, she is the daughter, eldest grandchild of Sarat Bose. She tells me it is 100% true. So many, you know, housewives, they could not cook up the same lie, that he had come there as Ziauddin, an insurance agent at Barari Coke Works. He had lunch, and then he had tea, and he had afternoon snacks, he had dinner also, and then they left in a car from there to, you know, from their house in Barari up to Gomo station, which they have now renamed as Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose station, and there he boarded this Kalka Mail. Another thing is, there's this guy called Bhagat Ram Talwar. Have you heard his name? Bhagat Ram Talwar, he was waiting in Peshawar to receive him. Bhagat Ram Talwar writes that Netaji, disembarked from this frontier mill. So a disconnect over here. Where did he change it in frontier mill? We don't know. Those things are all there actually. So I was not a witness. Yes, our friend at the back. No, I am not a researcher, but I'll tell you this thing. Actually, there's a wrong notion that has gone around. I am not a researcher. I am a translator. So I was translating all the works of Jayashree Patrika that is there in Bengali, copious works, this thing. And I wish that, you see, non-Bengalis, should also know these things. So I started translating, and that's how this all second-hand knowledge I am dishing about.
So one thing is, I am not able to think that what is the relation and how he is meeting with Mao, what is the relation at that time with China, his relation with China, or another thing is that he is visible in photograph at several places later on, but at that time no one has identified.
So that is the mystery. So can you put on some light? See, at that time, the one photograph is of this one. Just a moment. The Paris photograph was first, traced by one associated AP photograph. Anuj Dhar found it out. The credit goes to him. See, nobody at that time dreamed that Subhash Chandra Bose would be present there. Anuj Dhar, to his credit, actually had a suspicion. So there is an Associated Press photograph. I am showing you different photographs. This is not from the AP. This is a video that I traced out in the open domain. It is there. The British Pathé. This also I fished out from the British Pathé. This is, as you can see, this is still from a video. वो तब तो पता ही नहीं था किसी को जब बाद में सस्पिशन हुआ देन वी ऑल गॉट वाइज एंड वी स्टार्टेड लुकिंग वंस वी गॉट द क्लूज वी स्टार्टेड क्रैकिंग ऑन दैट एक चीज तो ये है दूसरी बात है लाइक दिस ताशकंद मैन उन दिनों तो दोज डेज देर वॉज नो एनोनिमस देर वॉज नो इंटरनेट नो हैकर This original picture was hacked out from some source. Somebody went into somebody's archives and hacked out the whole thing. Then we got wise and started looking in that place. Otherwise, looking for clues for Subhash Chandra Bose here and there is like looking for a needle in a haystack. Kahan milega? 90,000 videos are there in British Pathé. Kya aap usme se dhoond sakte ho? Agar aapko pata hi nahi hoga ki kahan par hai, to where will you look for? What the mind does not know, the eyes cannot see. पहले तो देखो videos were posted there decades back. After the internet revolution took place, videos were posted there. Even then we did not have any clue कि वो क्या हो सकता है वहाँ पर. It was only when this anonymous guy and Siddharth Sadbhai started talking about it, we all started looking for that. अगर हमें पता ही नहीं चलता कि ऐसा ऐसा कुछ हुआ है, एंड वी वुड नॉट नो व्हाट टू लुक फॉर एंड वेयर टू लुक फॉर, है ना. सो नाउ थिंग्स हैव कम आउट अबाउट द चाइना वॉर. थिंग्स वेर एग्जिस्टिंग. सी चाइना वॉर वी हैव नो फोटोग्राफ्स. वी हैव नो फोटोग्राफ्स. करेक्ट करेक्ट राइट राइट राइट. दोज आर फ्रॉम हिज लेटर्स टू पवित्र मोहन रॉय. पवित्र मोहन रॉय ही वॉज हिज इंटेलिजेंस ऑफिसर एंड लेटर ऑन ही गॉट इन टच विथ भगवान जी थ्रू लीला रॉय. Not through Leela Rai, I'm sorry. He got a through Atul Sen. Atul Sen told Pavitra Mohan Roy. Pavitra Mohan Roy went there in Nimsar. In Nimsar, he was given a list of things by Bhagwan Ji, ki ye mere liye le aao. Wo dekh karke usko chakkar aa gaya. It was a chronometer watch. Chronometer, you know what is a chronometer watch? That is a listed, you know, COSC, उसमें सर्टिफिकेशन होता है. तो that is certified in Switzerland only. उसका कुछ स्पेसिफिकेशंस होता है कि इतना सेकेंड का हेयर फेयर जो है ना, मे बी इन वन वीक फ्यू सेकेंड्स और समथिंग का हेयर फेयर अलाउड है. दैट मैकेनिकल वॉच, नॉट द क्वार्ट्ज. अभी तो जो लाइन वी आर वेयरिंग क्वार्ट्ज वॉच, दैट इज ऑल्सो गोइंग आउट नाउ इट इज़ नो बडी वेयर्स वॉचेस. सो COSC सर्टिफिकेशन इज डन. And a chronometer watch now costs rupees 2.5 lakhs like that. उन दिनों जो है ना 20,000 रुपया का घड़ी था वो. That is one. Number two, silk cloth of, you know, 1 meter or so width and 27 meters long. एक silk cloth, white, shimmering white silk cloth वो था. Crash proof briefcase. ब्रीफ केस जो है ना क्रैश होने से भी जो है ना इंटैक्ट रहेगा वो, ऐसा. देन और क्या क्या था उसमें, मैग्नीफाइंग ग्लास. सी साधु रिक्वायरिंग ऑल दोस दीज थिंग्स. यस ट्रांसमीटर आल्सो. जर्मन बिनोक्यूलर्स, आई डोंट नो वेदर इट वाज देयर इन द विच लिस्ट ऑफ और नॉट. सो वो जो लिस्ट देखा तो वो लाइक दैट वॉज, उसने हाथ खड़ा कर दिया कि मेरे बस की बात नहीं है. ही वेंट टू लीला रे. लीला रे हैड अ वास्ट नंबर ऑफ फॉलोअर्स. शी वॉज अ पोलिटिकल लीडर. कि आप जुगाड़ करो इसको. तो यहाँ वहाँ से लाइक समहाउ दे वर एबल टू, यू नो, गेट होल्ड ऑफ दीज थिंग्स एंड देन दे सेंट इट. सो दैट इज हाउ द थिंग बिगैन. देन ही स्टार्टेड राइटिंग लेटर्स टू, यू नो, पवित्र मोहन रॉय. तो एक एक लेटर में जो है ना ये सब चीज़ें मिली हैं कि लाइक ही वेंट देयर टू चाइना. एंड वन थिंग आई एम टेलिंग यू वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. द चाइनीज डिड अ यूनिलैटरल सीज फायर. टिल डेट नोबडी नोज व्हाट वाज द रीजन. इंडियन आर्मी वाज स्मैश्ड इन द नॉर्थ ईस्ट. दे कुड हैव जस्ट दे कुड हैव कट ऑफ द होल ऑफ असम. वो चिकन स्नैक जो है ना वो काट देना था उसको. तो व्हाट हैपेंड वाज curious thing, they went back, unilateral ceasefire, they went back to the McMahon line and they returned all our vehicles, all our equipment, all our artillery, our ammunition. They cleaned, polished and they, what do you call that, that labeling, जो labeling होता है ना वो पूरा लेबलिंग करके जो है ना लिस्ट बना के दे सेंड बैक. आई मीन एज इफ दे वर डूइंग अस ए ग्रेट फेवर. आई मीन फेवर. एंड ऑल आवर प्रिजनर्स वर वेरी वेल ट्रीटेड. किसी को कोई नुकसान नहीं पहुंचा एंड दे वर वेल लुक्ड आफ्टर एंड सेंड बैक. हैव यू टेल मी वन इंस्टेंस इन द वर्ल्ड हिस्ट्री वेयर दिस हैज हैपेंड. अमेजिंग थिंग. बट दिस हैपेंड. Yes, sure, sir. Please.
Thank you, sir, for a really nice talk. I actually had the same question as he had, a different version. So I was having a hard time just understanding the mind of a person who is trying to be incognito, at the same time he's appearing in important places, and he's not even using any simple disguise, knowing that cameras are there.
services. So it's very similar to what it's
sorry, what's your question?
The question was that
understanding this person, understanding this person's mind.
Yeah, like he wanted
people to people have spent 50, 60 years, they have not been able to figure out what was going on. Least of all me. I can't claim to understand actually.
Sir, a few days back we had one statement from his daughter Anita Bose that so we don't have any
she never uses that surname for your information. She has never used that surname. You're stepping on runners, that's what I can tell you. The government of India, actually the director of the intelligence bureau, yes, wrote a letter to Tribhuvan Narayan Singh, the governor of West Bengal, in 1979 that the intelligence bureau does not have any information regarding the marriage of Subhash Chandra Bose to a foreigner lady and a daughter born thereof. Ye government of India ka stand hai. That is one. Only thing, see, she has a facial resemblance to the Bose family. She has a facial resemblance somewhat to the Bose family. And a section of the Bose family are constantly claiming that she is the daughter. Till date, her mother, Emily Shankley, who was the stenographer, who was the personal assistant or stenographer or whatever, she used to take the dictation from him. She never visited India. Not that she denied that I am not the wife, etc. She never denied it. But she never used the surname. She never visited India. And initially in Sanmarg newspaper, the report was that a son was born to Subhash Chandra Bose. Later on, the son changed to daughter. So, daughter ho gaya. Now we have to put up with the daughter. And daughter is tom-tomming the air crash story everywhere. अब कैसा डॉक्टर समझ लो आप तो देखो शी इज टेलिंग दैट ऑल फाइल्स शुड बी डिक्लासिफाइड एक्सेप्ट इफ इट हर्ट समबडीज रेपुटेशन दैट शुड नॉट बी डिक्लासिफाइड नाउ इफ माय फादर गोज मिसिंग समवेयर आई विल रिप द वर्ल्ड अपार्ट की कहाँ गायब हो गया मेरा फादर वो भले उसमें किसी का रेपुटेशन जाए या जाए कहाँ गायब हो गया वो तो पहले निकालो But I mean, is it a reaction? I am not saying, I have every respect for her. She is a professor, retired professor of history, very educated person, suave, sober and all that. I have nothing against her. I mean, see, this behavior is unbecoming of a daughter. That's all I can say. And there is no proof of Netaji's marriage. Netaji ka apna jo application tha that for a passport in which he writes his status as unmarried in 1937 or 39, is it? While he is writing to the cadets in a written this thing, he says, I have no child of my own. So, फिर क्या झूठ बोल रहा था?
नहीं लेकिन उनका life अपने आप में बहुत secret और government of India उनके लिए झूठ हमेशा बोली है।
Government of India का तो सत्य में वे जयते जो है ना you know how ये है।
तो इतने सारे वो पता नहीं है वो झूठ हो सकता है
daughter. And whether she is the daughter or not, there is no proof whatsoever. Because intelligence bureau bata raha hai, humare paas koi kuch nahi hai. Toh hum toh usi ko manenge. IB ko hi manenge.
Sir, dekhne ke baad intelligence bureau ko manenge?
Kya?
Hum toh nahi manenge.
Kya chiz? Nahin, intelligence report ko dekho, manwane wali baat nahi hai. Humne ye research nahi kiya, ye toh... Nahin, aap baat suno. Intelligence Bureau, they are very intelligent people. They have kept their archives out of the, you know, RTI. वो दे नहीं रहे हैं। वही है वही RTI के बाहर है। And they have kept clauses also. Clause लगा दिया है। उसको उसी को मैं लिख रहा था आप आने से पहले। clause number 8 under bracket 1 under bracket A under bracket E and 11 under bracket 1. ये जो clauses है ना, that is if anything compromises the sovereignty of India, वो चीज़ हम देने के लिए मजबूर नहीं है, तो देंगे नहीं. What I suspect is that if he is to go to China and all that, if then certainly intelligence bureau will not write good things about him. Certainly intelligence bureau will not write good things about him. And now if the whole thing comes tumbling out of the closet, a lot of answering has to be done. Ki aapne aisa likha kyun aur 70 saal se aapne bola kyun ki mar gaya hai, that is also a big headache. How will you explain the actions? कि 70 साल से हमने ये चीज़ बोला है, अभी ये दूसरा बता रहा हूँ. Now person sitting in the hot seat will have to do the explanation, not somebody who has died in 1964 or 65. एक और बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग
क्वेश्चन मेरे को.
Yes sir. क्या
उसमें
उससे
कुछ इन्फॉर्मेशन आपको मिला? ज्यादा नहीं. सर प्लीज सर, बोलो सर, बोलिए सर.
पर्टिकुलरली रिगार्डिंग दिस इशू आई एम वेरी क्यूरियस टू नो दैट इफ नेताजी सर ही सर्वाइव्ड, then why he went into hiding? This might be a very naive question, please forgive me for asking.
It is not naive, it is absolutely pertinent. It is a pertinent question.
Satyendranath Bosu had written in his Bengali text that he considered that Netaji must have passed away, because he is a kind of person, if he is alive, he will lead.
He can't stay in hiding.
He cannot be in incognito. Uh-huh. Because he has the power, like the
Purushingo. It's all right, sir. What he used to tell his followers is that if he came out in the open, it will not be in the best interests of the country. Lot of innocent people will die. And the allied powers would be after him like nothing else. If he has indeed played this, you know, role in Vietnam, in China, and, you know, basically getting the Anglo-Americans out of the Eastern Hemisphere, that was basically getting the Anglo-American Western powers out of the Eastern Hemisphere, they will be after his blood like nothing, like nobody else. You know what has happened to Qasem Soleimani? What has happened? That Iranian general who was plucked in this Baghdad airport, a drone located him, and then there was a smart bomb which got him. Then there was this guy called Ayman al-Zawahiri, how he was located and a smart, you know, bomb got him. Wherever people are hiding, they are able to locate Osama bin Laden. So nowhere they could be protected. You may say that, okay, fine, how are you comparing Osama bin Laden with Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose? For as far as the West is concerned, he is a big time enemy. Sure, sir.
My question is, if Gumnami Baba was claiming so many big things, and we are having some indirect proofs also.
Absolutely. Okay?
But then in few letters to Pavitra Mohan Roy, he is writing like, I am starving, I do not have something to eat, so please help me, and you are not helping me. He is like,
he was always in need of money.
Like, like a child. So how can we reconcile these two aspects?
Also, India government knew, right? Apparently, he said that India government knew officially or unofficially.
See, actually, he had no independent income of his own. He might have been going here and there, but definitely at you know, he was being assisted by the powers behind the Iron Curtain. He was being assisted. And that he has also mentioned that, you know, these two powers, Russia and China, they have given him all assistance. And carte blanche, that is the word he used, carte blanche, wherever you want to go, whatever you need. But as long as he was, you know, operating behind the Iron Curtain. But when he was staying in India, he was staying incognito and at places, and he didn't have a source of income. he was dependent on his finances from Dulal Nandi and Leela Ray and her followers. So that way he used to run out of money quite frequently. He used to run out of money. So he was a known figure in international politics. He was a master of real politics. He was a master of geopolitics. But he didn't have any money. Even when he left India in through Afghanistan, he didn't have money in his pockets. If you look at his, you know, he's shaking hands with Hitler, look at his body language, standing bolt upright and shaking hands. No money in his pocket. So that way he was financially, he was a pauper. How to reconcile? I mean, yes, people, there were many people who wanted to support him, he did not take their support. That is also there.
Dr. Chatterjee,
so whether India government
presentation, I thought you enjoyed. I think a few months back we had Anuj also here.
Yes, so yes, we are very good friends.
It's excellent.
We are very good friends.
Now, I would just like your comments on one of my observations that you have shown a photograph of presumably Netaji with reference to the Tashkent meeting.
Yes.
And you quoted that Jo Ho Gaya So Ho Gaya. And you know the third person must be there. So that means Shastriji was knowing who he is. And if I trace back, that means even Pandit Nehru was knowing that, you know, Netaji is in India. I think looking at the number of people whom you have cited in your presentation, big names, so I cannot, no sensible person would believe that even Pandit Nehru was not aware that he is in the country. So, you know, this is my assessment of the whole thing. I would like to know your comment on this.
Sir, I haven't given my opinion here in any of
that. Oh. Yeah, I know that. I know. You said you didn't do research, you have translated. But, you know, as a wise person in this particular area, certainly more knowledgeable than I am.
Not really wise, sir. I'm a poor substitute for Anuj Dhar and Dr. Madhusudan Pal and Professor, you know, Kapil Kumar, and they are big people in this field. But yes, the government of India was aware of his presence by all accounts, as it looks like. Like if you look at one of the deposition, again I'm referring to somebody else's deposition, he is Mr. Vishambarnath Arora. Vishambarnath Arora, he wanted to meet him. He went that was Lucknowa Hatta. There, this Saraswati ji was, Saraswati Devi was sitting there. She was always sitting guard. So Saraswati Devi gave him a chit that you write your name, your particulars, and I'll send it in. It was sent in. He gave time the next day. The next day when he was about to go, a jeep came to his house, to V.N. Arora's house. Two people from the intelligence department, they introduced themselves, they invited themselves into his house. And they came in and sat and they said that we would like to have some tea and all that. So they started having tea and they started all, you know, fujul ki baat hai. So all this thing they started. He was getting fidgety and, you know, uncomfortable that he had to go and meet this Sadhu Baba there. Then he became very uncomfortable. Then these two fellows said that, why are you so fidgety and uncomfortable? Where do you want to go? Do you want to meet that Sadhu Baba there? So he said, yes. How do you know? Well, yesterday your scooter was standing there. We saw. See, that was way back in 1974. They were following anybody and everybody who was coming there. So they were keeping an eye on who's coming, who's going. And they brainwashed him into not going there. So if they did not know who the person sitting there was, how, see, they successfully prevented him from going there. They must have had some idea of, you know, who's sitting there. And on top of that, if you have been to Faizabad, he was staying in Ram Bhavan, which is in the civil lines, which is bang next to the SP's bungalow and DM's bungalow, and he's staying there. Is it possible that these people do not know? Administrative people, everybody knew. Everybody knew. So they knew what was going on.
Thank you.
somehow for some reason they did not want to ruffle the feathers. They never disturbed him there itself. They never disturbed him, and he did not disturb the others. Actually, the only thing he was, you know, keeping his secrecy was from the layperson and the media, that there should not be a big, you know, a big uproar about his presence and all that. That was what he was careful about. Whenever he used to stay in some place, whenever there used to be murmuring in the vicinity, somehow he would come to know of it and change his place, change his location. So that was how he was, you know, staying. Yes.
Sir, actually, a few months back, Anuja came.
Yes, yes.
And he gave a talk. So,
yes.
Inspired from that, I was wondering that the set date of the death was around June 1945.
No. 18th of August, 1945.
Yeah, August.
Yeah.
Around those side. So,
it was specifically on the 18th of August, 1945. Yeah.
I was wondering what All India Radio would have conveyed to the people. So, I did a Google search.
The moment they received the news, they spread the good tidings all over.
Yes, sir. Regarding that, I was looking through the archives. Before independence, it was the Indian Listener. They used to publish a magazine of the All India Radio proceedings fortnightly. So I was looking searching through the magazines in the month of August volume, July volume, June volume, and also the end.
Yeah, July, August, August 24th or 22nd was the date in which Domain News Agency of Japan, they announced. It was not the government of Japan, it was Domain News Agency, it was a private agency. They announced.
So I was searching that how that news was published in Indian Listener, so I didn't found any mention of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose.
No, later on the news was published all over. Subhash Chandra Bose dies in air crash, that was published. Big headlines everywhere. At a later date, maybe 25th, 26th of August.
I searched August, September, October, and I searched manually and also with control, find either the word Netaji or Subhash. Like, I searched adamantly.
It was very big news, actually.
But it was not. I might be wrong. But
It was published. Such good news, how can it not be published? It's a huge relief to the, you know whom.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, please.
Sir, actually, during the Vietnam War, the CIA would have been closely following the military of Vietnam. So when they went to the Paris peace talks, they might be aware of the nine generals which he was talking about, and they might not be aware of the shadow behind them. So basically, why can they question that who is this 10th man behind you, what is he doing there, he is a 70-year-old man, and might be possible they might have inquired on him, that's my question.
How do you know they did not inquire? The reports are that, now you are prodding me more and more to speak more. So, they asked the French intelligence that you get hold of that fellow, he is wanted in 9 countries. The Americans told the French, you get hold of that fellow. The French apparently so put their foot down, is that he is carrying a diplomatic passport. We can't touch him. And he was never leaving the company of the Vietnamese. So, suddenly you can't, jump upon the Vietnamese delegation and snatch one person and go away. So this old man was too smart.
Sir, maybe I will just have one last question.
Yes, of course.
Sir, because I know that you also coach many students in hockey, because I closely follow you, I would like to know how would your advice be regarding connected to extracurricular activities in terms of sports and other stuff to be an efficient either social activist or leader? Because I feel that there is a huge lack of leadership credibilities inside and outside academia or this institute. I
No, I never thought in those terms. Actually, morning, I 1 hour I punctually take out for the hockey field. That's true. I was not a very good hockey player, and but then I was able to, you know, churn out a lot of hockey players. So there in Kolkata, you have to take out a little bit of time. And volunteerism is not in our culture actually. Volunteerism, that is called volunteerism. You're a volunteer, and nobody will pay me for that. I don't depend on that for a living. So I think we need to inculcate that volunteerism in our culture. I found actually this Bloemendaal, have you heard of Bloemendaal Hockey Club in Holland? They have got 3 or 4 artificial turfs, 1 natural turf. They have got players ranging from 7-8 years to 80 years. So it's a cultural thing actually. So,
and sir, how do you see that in connection to building an efficient leadership? Because we are talking on 23rd.
I'm not a leader.
Yes. Sir, how do you see that in connect to build an efficient leadership quality?
No, I never thought about it actually. I've never thought in those terms. I mean, it's, I like the game, and I'm still able to play. I play for the veterans. Veterans matches, Kolkata, there are a lot of veterans who play. So whenever there's a game, I play with them. And I have my team also, they're going to play in Super Division this year. So
thanks a lot, sir. Maybe moving ahead to the INA National Anthem version, and before requesting you to stand for all of it, I would request everyone to give a very big applause for the speaker and all the round of applause. I do not think this kind of talks would have been organized. I also thank all our volunteers and request them to come ahead so that we can stand alongside sir while we play the INA version of National Anthem. Nilabjo, Shubrato, Sneha, again, please come in front. Please. Please come.
Who knows the full song?
Sir, we have the version.
Where?
Sir, we have the version there.
Okay. सुख चैन की बरखा बरसे भारत भार हो जागा पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंग चंचल सागर विंध्य हिमालय नीला जमुना गंगा मेरे नित गुण गाए तुझसे जीवन पाए तन पाए आशा सूरज बन कर जग पर चमके भारत भागे भागा जय हो जय हो जय 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 हो भारत भाग सुभागा तेरे पंख पखेरु गुल गाए बास भरे भरपूर हवाए जीवन के सुख लाए कर हिंद पुकारे ये आजाद हिंद के नारे देश हमारा सूरज बन कर जग पर चमके भारत नाम सुभागा जय हो जय हो, जय 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 हो, नाम सुभा।
Thank you everyone, good night. Thank you very much for attending this session. And sir, especially thank you for traveling such a long way to pay tribute to Subhash Chandra Bose on his 126th.
It was a big, big privilege for me.
Thank you. Can I request maybe Apaji or whoever the official photographer is just to have one official photograph with Arnav sir and the volunteers and the speaker. Mr. Raghunath sir and Vishnu sir also please.
हाँ हाँ जस्ट सर, लाइक अभी तक गवर्नमेंट ने अप्रूवल नहीं दिया है फाइनली, तो देन जो मतलब जहाँ पे वो रहते थे वो सारी प्राइवेट जगह थी, तो लाइक उनको मतलब लोग हथियार हैं, मतलब जैसे ही मैं बस्ती में ही रहता हूँ, मेरा घर बस्ती में बस 4 किलोमीटर दूर है वो राजा बहरा।
अच्छा,
वहाँ पे
पीछे से नहीं
आ जाएगा।